Well, I'd like to present my top five pearls for doing phaco with a crowded anterior chamber. And I have no financial interest in this topic. So we have a lot of different challenges with these eyes. First of all, we have to calculate the IOL power correctly. And so often, as you know, we get a myopic surprise. We have to worry about greater endothelial cell loss because, after all, this is like doing phaco in the anterior chamber. These eyes typically have a very small pupil and as well a floppy bag. It's almost as if the bag is too big, so it's very lax and it's easy to aspirate the posterior capsule. We know there are greater risk for suprachoroidal hemorrhage or effusion. And then postoperatively, we can...
Somehow doesn't seem to be playing.
...very lax, and it's easy to aspirate the posterior capsule. We know there are greater risk for suprachoroidal hemorrhage or effusion. And then postoperatively, we can even have a situation where the chamber remains shallow. So pearl number one is to consider using also, in addition to your regular formula, the Kane formula, which you can get at this URL, iolformula.com. This is Jack Kane from Australia, and it's free online. And I run it for cases with a short axial length. Here's his paper showing 10 different formulas. And most of them err on the myopic side. Everything below this line is a myopic error. And you can see that the shorter the eye gets, the greater the error. And so the one formula that did the best was his formula, which uses an artificial intelligence component as well as regression analysis. Now, pearl number two is to always use a dispersive viscoelastic, such as I've shown here, to protect the cornea. But remember that you have to aspirate it above, right above such a brunescent nucleus. Otherwise, when you start sculpting, you can get a clogged phaco tip with this thick viscoelastic mixing with the brunescent nuclear material. Pearl number three is to use a subincisional iris retractor the minute you get any iris prolapse like this. I don't need four retractors, the pupil's still large, but the problem is if I keep inserting instruments over that iris, it's going to fray it and cause further trauma. So I stop and I place a subincisional retractor through a different clear corneal stab incision so that my instruments go through the clear corneal incision and they're not rubbing against the retractor. And you can see how when I do both the phaco and later the INA, that this pulls that iris down and out of the path of the instrument so we don't further traumatize it. And it's key to do this the minute this happens. Of course, you could try intracameral phenylephrine. The next pearl is to use a CTR for the reasons that I said with the floppy bag. Here's the 28.5 diopter IOL. And this puts it on a stretch. And in those cases where I've had shallowing of the anterior chamber, when I've done the other eye with the CTR, this seems to help to mitigate that. This is a paper that I published in 2001 with four cases of extremely shallow anterior chambers where I did a vitreous tap. So I'm going 3 millimeters behind the limbus with the MVR blade and then doing a vitrector without infusion to just soften the eye. You take a little bit out and then that lets me deepen the chamber. So we'll show a case with a very dense lens, an extremely shallow chamber. And this is not the most common presentation, but occasionally you do see this. And here I am in the oblique quadrant, 3 millimeters behind the limbus. Now I'm going to take my MVR blade and I'm going to aim posteriorly toward the optic nerve so that I don't have any chance of hitting the lens. Here's the vitrector without infusion. It's a small gauge vitrector. And I'm just going to remove just a little bit. You only need to take out perhaps 0.2 mLs. And I'm palpating so that I make sure I don't soften the globe too much in the process. I just want to soften enough so that I can now fit in some more dispersive viscoelastic. These eyes not only have posterior synechii, but you can see here that the iris stroma is really stuck to the lens, because the lens being pushed forward, in essence, creates much greater contact with the mid-iris stroma. Now, you have to deal with the small pupil. So here's a Malugin ring. Of course, I have to put in some dye. And I like doing phaco chop in these cases to reduce the amount of ultrasound energy. But what you can tell is I have a much better chance of success by having essentially a chamber of normal depth. And here you can see the case at the end, closing with an interrupted atovicral suture for the pars plana sclerotomy. I'll show a second case. Similar again, but you can see there's a YAG iridotomy superiorly, a bound pupil, a dense lens, so very similar. And these cases, it's hard because the minute you go in, you're almost right up against the iris. You're not able to deepen the chamber without making the eye really firm. So again, through a conjunctival peritomy, I go 3 millimeters back, I aim toward the optic nerve. Now, you can't do this technique if it's a non-ophthalmic eye, because you don't know where the pars plana ends. So you have to do this when it's a 20 or 21 millimeter or longer eye to consider this. And again, I'm trying to take a little at a time. The vitrectomy means that I'm not putting vitreous traction on, but I can be very controlled in the amount that I'm withdrawing, as opposed to, say, putting in a needle to try to aspirate it. And again, you have to be careful not to make the eye too soft. Clearly, you avoid hitting the lens by aiming posterior. And then now a welcome sight that I can deepen the chamber and then do whatever technique is best, closing with the sclerotomy. So be aware again if it's too short of an eye. So hopefully these tips are of value. Remember to use the cane formula, to use a dispersive viscoelastic, frequently refill the eye with this, manage the small pupil, don't try to be a hero with that. Be aware that the bag is easier to aspirate and consider a CTR. You can do an extra cap in these cases with because you're trying to protect the endothelium, but again, they do have a greater risk of suprachoroidal hemorrhage and effusion. And that CTR, I think, helps to maintain a normal chamber depth postoperatively. Thank you very much.